All meetings are to be open, all meetings are to be public, all discussions of public business are to be open to the public and advertised. What we have here, though, by incorporating litigation and the secrecy of the mediation process, the confidentiality that's required by the mediation process, is we have government business being conducted outside of the sunshine. The mere fact that the city council members are all apprised of the details of this, I presume by general counsel's office running to each one of the city council members in turn rather than having them meet and discuss it all together, which would violate the sunshine law. I think it is a method of evading the effects of the sunshine law. And there's nothing that says that you couldn't use it, not just in this county, but any county. You couldn't use litigation, potentially friendly litigation, by somebody who wants a contract with the county to accomplish the same goal. You know, you always come up and say, well, as due to a process of mediation, we've now concluded that we have to give them this contract without any sort of bidding process. So that is another aspect of this has got to be addressed, because if it's going to be used as a method of evading public input into public business, then obviously what should happen here is that the case should go on. Court should decide whether or not the contract that was drafted 20 years ago, and it does in truth give Waste Management the right to operate the landfill for an eternity, or whether it ends.
Yes.
And then we proceed to go ahead and bid out another landfill.
Very good. Christy, do you have anything to add to that special issue that we came up with last minute here because of the timing of news articles and developments? But you're our special guest today, and you're kind of in the media yourself, aren't you?
Yes, I co-host a radio show on Thursday mornings. It's actually out of Orlando. It's with Doug Kosarek. It's called Wake Up with Doug K. And we talk about Florida politics, what's going on across the state, and specifically in Orlando and Jacksonville.
Very good. So you can tell us about what's going on in Orlando.
A little bit. A little bit about it. I tend to focus more on Jacksonville since I'm here, but we get some callers from Daytona and Jacksonville and Orlando that kind of keep us up to date on municipal elections and those sorts of things as well.
Are things similar in Orlando and Jacksonville, would you have to say?
I think Orlando, at least the outskirts of Orlando, a lot of the people in those smaller little like subdivision type cities that have their own city councils and those sorts of things, they seem to be a little bit more open to understanding that it's their right to remove people if they do not vote the way they're supposed to. Winter Haven, for example, most of their citizens are against SunRail, against the Tri-Rail, the whole project. And they removed, I believe, everybody but three people in their municipal elections last week. They voted everybody out that voted the wrong way. So it seems like they are a little more open to those sorts of things than what the people in Jacksonville kind of believe, that if you have experience and if you're already in the city council, almost like it's your right to remain there regardless of what your record is.
More activism among the voters.
Yes, definitely.
So that's very interesting. Now, you're Republican, you're sitting here with three Democrats, you're in the Republican Liberty Caucus.
Yes, sir.
Which has somewhat split off or opposed to the Republican Party in all around the country to some extent. What is the outlook of that group, and where are you different from the Republican Party itself?
The Republican Party, I would actually say that we're working within the Republican Party, so our ultimate goal is to work with them, but because of the way they have chosen to do business lately, it seems that we're more against them.
Oh, so there is some hope that they will see things your way eventually.
Eventually,
right?
That would be the end result we'd be looking for. But
great.
The biggest difference between the Republican Liberty Caucus and the Republican Party is that the Republican Party is more about winning. They care, they want to get Republicans in office. Mm-hmm. If you have an R next to your name, then they believe that you deserve the support of the party. The Republican Liberty Caucus decides who is worthy of winning in a different way. We start out from a foundation of principles based on the Constitution, and we want to find candidates that fit that versus just finding candidates that call themselves Republican regardless of what they stand for. And so because we're not afraid to call out other Republicans that vote for things like the tri-rail or the stimulus package or cap and trade, and we believe that they should be opposed, the party does not like us because they are about winning. And principles, for them it's party over principles, and for us it's principles over party.
Well, we know that in Duval County, where Republicans have managed to dominate the local government for quite some time now, and So I concur with you that they are about winning. I wish Democrats were more about winning sometimes. But when you select candidates with principles, they're not always going to win. I guess that's what we learned from all of this.
Well, it isn't that we'd rather be right than president. We'd rather be right and president.
Right. That is first choice. Choice number one, having your cake and eating it too.
Yes.
Well, I think that the really neat thing about the Republican Liberty Caucus is that we have Gloria Johnson. Councilwoman Johnson is actually a member of the RLC. I spoke with her last night. So we have a big tent philosophy. If you agree with us on a lot of the issues, and with her, we agree with her on most of the fiscal issues, and we welcome people. One of the things that my co-host on the radio, it's actually his show, but he says that the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence is the biggest tent there is. So that means that libertarians are welcome and Democrats are welcome, and whoever is fighting for those principles.
Okay, I thought I heard you say that Democrats are welcome to the Republican Liberty Caucus. That's obviously a mistake. Is that really true, Christy?
That is true. Like I said, Gloria Johnson is a Democrat, and she is a member of the RLC here in Jacksonville.
Okay, so I heard you right.
You did, yes.
You mean you actually adhere to the First Amendment principles?
Yes, I know. It's shocking. Very shocking.
How refreshing.
Conrad comes from a long series of meetings with the mayor on the budget. And, right, you've been attending a lot of these meetings and trying to get your two cents in, and it isn't always easy. That's great. I think that's interesting. Well, I'll have to put that on my calendar to attend the RLC.
So our next meeting is actually about taxes, so you guys might enjoy that. Whether the income tax is constitutional, if it was correctly ratified, and those sorts of things. So.
And where and when is that? Do you happen to know offhand?
The date is April 6th.
Okay.
And the actual meeting portion starts at 7. We serve food and alcohol and drinks before the meeting. And it's at the Sheraton on Bay Meadows between Phillips and 95.
Okay, great.
And we're actually, Steve Hempling is coming in to speak with us from California to do his presentation on the income tax. So.
And Steve Hempling is an office holder there, or maybe not, huh?
He's not. He actually has been doing seminars around the country. He has gone against the feds on that issue on whether the income tax is constitutional, and has won a few cases based on that, done several presentations, that kind of thing. So he's going to come in and tell us what he's found out and what his experience has been with the federal government on that issue.
Now, the Democratic Party has potluck suppers, typically. There you are, meeting at the Sheraton Inn for food and drinks. I find that interesting. So you are a Republican, but you're in the Republican Liberty Caucus, which is somewhat of at odds with the mainstream Republican Party.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. We have the concerned taxpayers, of course. We are nonpartisan, and we accept Democrats, Republicans, Libertarians, and anyone from any of the numerous minor parties around the state, too, which there are many. But what about the Tea Party? Is this, do you coincide with that whole movement or not?
The Tea Party movement, I think, as a whole, kind of the way I've described it is, I think Americans across the board are upset and they're angry. They don't really know what to do with that anger. And so this was kind of their answer to, we don't like what's going on. And I think it's interesting with the Tea Parties to note that it started really under President Bush with that first stimulus package, or whatever you want to call it. I guess there's a whole bunch of different terms, but I mean, that's pretty much what it was. and then has continued under Obama. So I think that's really neat that they have kind of the nonpartisan thing going as well. The biggest difference between them and the